The thing that surprised me a lot is that you find ways to adapt to it somehow. I mean, I never thought that I would be able to deal with death or even be able to think about death in the way that I do now, because I've seen it a whole different way. I mean, after having the experience of really watching death, and especially because unfortunately AIDS is a very the disease itself can be very painful and very very ugly disease. I mean, it's not pretty. It's not painless, and it's not quick. And so there's a lot of sort of suffering that goes with the thing, and there's a lot of sort of pain that you've got to sort of deal with, psychological and physical pain.
This is ABC News Nightline. Reporting from Washington, Ted Koppel.
Good evening. The disease has already claimed more victims than Legionnaire's disease and toxic shock syndrome combined. More than 800 cases nationwide, 300 plus of those fatal. And every day, three more cases are identified. And yet, still, surprisingly few people are familiar with the acquired immune deficiency syndrome, or the acronym by which it's frequently identified, AIDS. The reason for that may lie in part in the character of its most common victims. When AIDS first cropped up about 18 months ago, almost all its victims were homosexual males who frequently changed sexual partners. Alarming enough to that particular segment of society, but so it first appeared, not threatening to the public at large. But that seems to be changing, and the disease may be spreading.
Federal health officials consider it an epidemic, yet you rarely hear a thing about it. At first, it seemed to strike only one segment of the population. Now, Barry Peterson tells us, this is no longer the case.
Scientists at the National Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta today released the results of a study which shows that the lifestyle of some male homosexuals has triggered an epidemic of a rare form of cancer. Robert Bazell now in Atlanta.
In 1981, five gay men in Los Angeles came to be the first patients treated for AIDS-related symptoms. Rumors linking the mysterious disease with the men's sexuality arose, and it came to be nicknamed gay cancer. The term acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, or AIDS, wasn't penned until over a year after. At the same time that AIDS was rising in the media, so was a 24-year-old gay artist by the name of Keith Haring. Haring was born in Reading, Pennsylvania in 1958. From a young age, he was inspired by his father to start drawing, and he continued throughout his adolescence. After high school, he attended a corporate art school in Pittsburgh for a few months before eventually moving to the School of Visual Arts in New York City. Once in New York, Haring was exposed to the works of Andy Warhol and Jean-Michel Basquiat, and he saw new directions that he could take his art. What started as illegal subway chalk murals soon turned into paintings worth thousands of dollars. Haring never lost track of what he felt his main purpose was with his art, which was to create for the people. He tried his best to make sure his larger pieces were in places that could be enjoyed by many, and always made sure that more affordable works of art were available for consumption. Later on, during the trying years of the AIDS epidemic, Haring's community-driven spirit seemed to only grow.
The word God is an abomination. To practice one's sexuality, the same is true for, like, Archbishop Carroll, who took the stand that he would go to jail rather than to hire known homosexuals into their schools. And our pastor said that he would do the same and would even burn the school rather than allow them to be taught by homosexuals. And we feel as strongly.
The 80s were a time of rampant homophobia, so when the gay community began to be affected by AIDS, it didn't take long for the public to jump to conclusions and blame their sexuality. Due to the lack of support for the LGBTQ community, there wasn't a fast enough response to try and find a cure for the disease. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration is the agency that acts as the gatekeepers to the drugs and treatment available to the public. they had an extremely slow response to trying to treat the epidemic. Many believe that this is because the majority of those affected by AIDS were in the LGBTQ community, and in many ways the federal government was still very homophobic. Ronald Reagan was president for most of the 80s, and it wasn't until 1985 that he ever publicly said the word AIDS. His administration set a precedent to turning a blind eye to the crisis. With mainstream culture for the most part ignoring the epidemic, it was up to activists and organizations to spread information and awareness. Keith Haring was one such person who took on this role. Haring was officially diagnosed with AIDS in 1988 when he found lesions linked to Kaposi's sarcoma on various parts of his body. He said that deep down he knew he was sick, but it wasn't something he wanted to give in to. By this time, the epidemic had already been raging on for about 6 years, so he had already watched countless numbers of friends and ex-lovers get sick and die. Some of his activism had by this point been branching into safe sex awareness, but his AIDS-based art took on a different meaning after his diagnosis. The use of condoms was still considered a highly taboo subject in the 80s, even though they were a way to avoid the spreading of HIV. The fact that Keith Haring explicitly focused on condom usage and male sexuality in his art was barrier-breaking. By this point, he was already becoming a fairly well-known artist with gallery openings, international commissions, and corporate sponsors. Since he had reached this point of notoriety, he had a platform where people would really listen to what he had to say. Haring had the guts to spread the awareness that mainstream media didn't always see as necessary, and tried to fight the causes of the disease. What he couldn't fight forever, though, were the effects.
I'm John Norris, sitting in for Kurt Loder. This is The Week in Rock. The AIDS epidemic has claimed the life of another major talent, this time from the world of art. Keith Haring, the best-known and best-loved pop artist of the 1980s, died in his sleep early Friday morning at his home in New York of AIDS-related complications.
Keith Haring contracted many other infections after his initial diagnosis of AIDS, and with an already weakened immune system, he succumbed to his symptoms on February 16, 1990 at the age of 31. Even without new creations, his art continued to live on without him. He wanted his art to be seen by everyone because he created it for all people. This goal was definitely achieved. He still has 30 public murals standing almost 40 years later, and his other pieces have been distributed around the world. The impact he made with his messages has not been forgotten, and the risks he took have not been taken for granted. Keith Haring was not the first person to die of AIDS, and he certainly was not the last. All we can do now is continue spreading his message and keep striving for an AIDS-free world.